Well, it is July the 3rd. So, in light of Independence Day tomorrow, I thought I would preach to you tonight on that theme. And I still love our country, don't you? I love our country. I am incredibly proud to be an American and thankful. Being born in this country, even though it's weird right now, being born in this country has been an incredible gift. Incredible gift. But just to clarify, the reason that I love America is not because I was born here, nor that the land is beautiful or prosperous or what have you. I am in love, personally, with the idea of America. That really is what America is. Is a set of principles, an idea. I'm in love with liberty, for example. If America has been known for anything, I would say predominantly it has been freedom. It has been America. It has been liberty. Freedom has been the engine driving our country to its place atop the world. Freedom has been our nation's most cherished possession. It has been the birthright of every American for 248 years tomorrow. That's astounding. I think many people, uneducated people who don't think very well, talk about how old some of the European countries are. That's nonsense. That's nonsense. Well, we read about Spain in the Bible. It's thousands and thousands of years old. No. I mean, the territory called Spain, yes, but the system of government that's in place there has been toppled and changed dozens of times, as recently as the 70s. America has been one nation, basically as founded, 250 years, far surpassing anyone else. We are a great nation, a great people. And so valuable has our freedom been that we have gone to war time and again to protect it. At one time, even the most meager encroachment against it was met with fierce resistance. I don't know if you realize this, but you know that the initial battles of the Revolution occurred after British troops tried to seize the colonists' private weapons. The Massachusetts colonists rebelled after British agents received writs of assistance allowing them not to seize, but merely to search the colonists' property. And they said, over my dead body, we're not doing that. Connecticut rebelled in part because the British were undermining the independence of judges. Now, I'm sorry to say that if we still had these principles, we would have gone to war long ago. But Maine revolted because the British Parliament issued a decree confiscating every white pine tree in the colony. My personal favorite is Virginia. They revolted in part because King George imposed a 2 pence tax on the sale of a pound of tea. Man, can you imagine what those people would have done if they lived in Parker County and had to pay our property taxes? Woo! Each of these abuses of the rights and the liberties of the citizenry were minor by today's standards. But liberty-loving Americans at the time of the founding, they would not put up with it. They would not tolerate them. But of course, times have changed. I'm sad to say that the lamps of liberty have been all but extinguished beneath the constant expansion, the constant growth of government power. In James Bovard's book, he wrote a book called Lost Rights, and he documents in that text with painstaking thoroughness how federal, how state, how local governments are confiscating citizens' property, trampling their rights, decimating their opportunities more and more, more than ever before. We live in an almost tyrannical government. He points out that Americans today have to obey far more than 30 times more laws as their great-grandfathers had to obey at the turn of the century. Now, let me change that. We say we have to obey more laws. What that means is though they were 30 times more free than we. That's what that means. Our grandparents were 30 times more free than we are today. Today, government bureaucrats publish hundreds and hundreds of pages, not individual rulings, but pages of rulings, pages of regulations. And they do it not each year, not each month, not even each week. They publish over 200 pages of new rules and regulations every business day. There is not a single aspect of your life that is not regulated to death. I saw Elon Musk talk about the rules and regulations he has to follow to build a car, and he said the rules would not fit in this building. The boxes of stuff they have to go through, it's mind-boggling. The bloated size of the federal statute book is one of the clearest measures of the increase in government control of the citizenry. More than 30 years ago, not under a good administration, under the Clinton administration, they had a panel on reinventing government. They didn't do a very good job reinventing it, but anyway, they had a panel on reinventing government, and it noted, quote, the full stack of personnel laws, regulations, directives, case law, and departmental guidance that the Agriculture Department alone uses weighs over 1,000 pounds. Just the guidance book for the Ag Department. Now, thankfully, things have gotten much better since the Clinton administration, right? No, they haven't. They haven't. But why not? They were going to reinvent government, so why isn't it better? Is it because there is a tyrant in Washington determined to control every aspect of our lives? Is that what's happened? Is that what Bush was? Is that what Bush again was? Is that what Obama and then Trump? Is that what we have? We had a dictator in power who's been determined to ruin our lives individually? No. Is it because, is it so the NSA can sit in on a secret room and listen to your telephone conversations to make sure that your speech follows the party lines? Is there some grand conspiracy behind the scenes? Well, you may think so, but I'm going to stipulate tonight that for our purposes, the answer is no. That's certainly not primarily why. Instead, I would submit to you that there is an irrefutable lesson to be learned both from history and from our text tonight, which is that a people's sin inevitably, eventually, will be their own undoing. Open your Bibles tonight to the book of Proverbs, please, chapter 28. Let's stand together. Okay. Proverbs 28 in verse number 2. For the transgression of a land, for the transgression of a land, many are the princes thereof. But by a man of understanding and knowledge, the state thereof shall be prolonged. I preach to you a simple message from this verse entitled, Making Liberty Last. Making Liberty Last. Lord, we love you. God, thank you for your word. It is incredibly clear. Not always easy to do, but it is at least easy to comprehend. I pray that you'll help us to do that tonight and then to determine to make changes that will be in line with what you say. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. For the transgression of a land, many are the princes thereof, but by a man of understanding and knowledge the state thereof shall be prolonged. At first glance, it is tempting to think that this phrase, many princes, is a reference to a change in dynasties. That would fit the Old Testament context pretty well. And Derek Kidner, in his commentary on this, points out that in just over two centuries, right? So after Israel, after the kingdom under Solomon split, you had Rehoboam take part and Jeroboam take part. And then the northern part where Jeroboam was reigning, which is called Israel, the southern part was the kingdom of Judah. So they lasted for over two centuries. They had a long run in Israel. And in just over two centuries, northern Israel, because of its sins, had nine dynasties. Nine dynasties. Not individual rulers, but dynasties. Each after the first inaugurated by an assassination. There was a coup, and then a new group guy came to power, and so on and so forth. Whereas in the 3.5 centuries that Judah existed, because of David's sake, they had only one. They had only one. So you can see the sins. I mean, you know about Israel's sins because of the sins of the sons of Jeroboam caused Israel to sin and their idolatry. They had one dynasty after the other. And so, you know, in reality, though, even though Mr. Kidner's point is well taken, and although it does correspond with this text, that is really not what this passage is talking about. That is not the danger of which this text is warning. This passage is not saying that a nation, because of its transgression, will have many rulers within a short period of time. What it is actually saying, what it's actually warning against, is that a people whose heart is set on rebellion, you want to go away from God, you don't want to do what God or what the law says, a people whose heart is set on rebellion will be forced to endure many rulers at the same time. So it's not talking about several rulers in succession, it's talking about many rulers simultaneously. Now, to make this clear, I should point out that the word translated princes here, we often think of a prince as like the ruler, the king, whatever. But the word princes is elsewhere translated as principal or keeper or governor, right? And so the idea is that when the people of a land will not regulate themselves, then they will have to be regulated. They'll have to be governed. Typically by a sprawling, bureaucratic, regulatory state, which is exactly what we have in America today. We have to have many people watching out to see that everything gets done. Paul Harvey, how many of you are old enough to remember Paul Harvey? Praise God, all right? I grew up listening to Paul Harvey, and he summed up this idea best when he said, self-government without self-discipline won't work. It's exactly the truth. Self-government won't work without self-discipline. It wouldn't work in Solomon's day, and it will not work in our day. And you can almost understand the incredible growth of regulation when you learn, I read a study that said they tested 103 different brands of bottled water. You know what they found? They found that 1/3 of them are no more pure, no more healthful, no more anything than the water out of the water fountain right there. It's just junk, okay? They're not any better for you than the water out of your kitchen faucet. Another report I saw said that half of all the car repairs done in the U.S. are unnecessary. And so, what's the result of that? Well, now we have an enormous Federal Bureau of Consumer Protection. Because people can't be honest and do what they're supposed to do, we have to have some regulatory agency come in here and say, watch out for this and watch out for that and watch out for the other thing. Is everybody with me? And it's this way in every area. For the transgression of a land, because people are dishonest, because they will rebel against what is right, what is true, what is legal, for the transgression of a land, many are the princes thereof. You got to have a lot of people. It's incredible, isn't it? I mean, it's just incredible. And more than that, it's terrible. This is an awful state of affairs. We are losing our freedom. We are losing our country. And yet, it is exactly what God said would happen. It's exactly what God said would happen. But, and thank God that word is in there, amen? But, says Solomon, by a man of understanding and knowledge, the state thereof shall be prolonged. Now, this is the good half of the verse. This is one of those antithetical parallelisms where you have a bad side and then you have a good side, all right? The bad side is first. Now we have the good side of the verse. But we need to make sure that we understand what it means. Notice the verse at the end, the second half. My man of understanding and knowledge, the state, look at the little word there, thereof. Everybody see that? What's unique about that word? Somebody say it out loud. It's italicized. It's italicized. Now, some people who are new to reading their Bible think that the italicized words are there for emphasis. Yay, this is important. No, that's not what it's there for. Okay? That's not. The word is italicized not for emphasis, but rather to indicate that it is not part of the original text. That word is not in Hebrew. Okay? That was added by the translators for clarity. And they italicized it so that you would know that they added it, okay? That's the whole purpose. Now, typically, when I come across these italicized editions, I approach them cautiously. Because, again, they're not part of the text, so you need to make sure that you recognize that. But in this case, I find the word to be helpful because without it, the word state looks like a noun. But they have correctly pointed out that the word state in this verse is functioning as an adjective. Okay? It describes not the condition of the princes, but of the land which is being overregulated. Okay? So what is being said here, as far as I can tell, is that a man of understanding and knowledge will be able either to prevent the regulation from being necessary, or perhaps to restore liberty once it has been lost. Does anybody see that? A land, because of its transgression, because of its rebellion against God and truth and what is right, they're going to find themselves having many rulers and overseers and regulators and governors. But if we get someone, the right person, they can roll that back or prevent that from happening. All right? Now, certainly, it is easy to see this borne out in the history of Israel. For example, let's go back to the book of the Judges. In the times of the Judges, the people would sin against God, and because of their sin, oppression would come in, there would be all these terrible things, and then God would raise up unto them a judge, Othniel, Ehud, Samson later, Barak, or whoever it was. A man of understanding, someone who knew God or had a relationship with him, like Othniel, especially at the beginning, they would come in and they would love the Lord, they would know God properly, and then they would deliver the people and bring them back to peace and prosperity and a wonderful state of affairs, right? He would not only keep them from getting worse, he would restore them, at least to some degree, back to God and restore them back to liberty and prosperity. All the things that they had lost by transgression could be undone. Now, that arrangement worked pretty well in their time, which after the time of Saul, the kingdoms of Israel were dynastic monarchies, all right? And so even after the reign of a sinful king, his son, for example, could ascend to the throne. And if the father had been a deadbeat loser like Saul, then you might get someone wonderful like Jonathan. Or after David, you get a Solomon or something along those lines. All right? And as an example of this, of a good man coming on after the scene and restoring things back to how they would be, I would refer to you in our series through 2 Kings, I would refer to you to the reign of good King Josiah after the horrific reign of his father Amon, right? Everybody remember this? Okay, and so Amon takes the country down, this horrible road, and then Josiah, he's the best king of all time and brings it back. And so it's a wonderful thing. Now, unquestionably, that is a major point of the text. However, I want to show you one other thing. The Hebrew word that is translated as man, notice what it says here, but by a man of understanding and knowledge, That word that is translated amen is just, it's an imprecise word. It's just the word Adam, Adam. And it's used 552 times in the Old Testament. And in the overwhelming majority, it is used in a very general sense. It's not a name or a title of a particular person. It's just, what I'm getting at is that when you and I see amen, what are we thinking of? We think of a king, an individual, a ruler, a particular person. But to them, most often this referred to just mankind, right? To men is in the aggregate sense. And so in other words, when the Jews read this, what they would likely have taken from this verse is that not only do the people of a land by their rebellion mess things up, but also the people of the land, if they have understanding and knowledge, can fix it and thereby prolong their liberties. Everybody with me? That's what's being said here. And that sense fits very well in our own economy, where the rulers come from where? From the people. All right? Leaders do not ascend in America. We do not ascend to the throne, although we're becoming more and more like that, where we have dynastic families, don't we? Amen? Sick of the Bushes, sick of the Clintons, right? All this kind of thing. Well, anyway, our leaders are supposed to ascend from the people themselves. And therefore, in our case, even if we had this kind of, you know, families from which we get all of our leaders, even in our case, if the people would change, they would pick different leaders. It's that simple. And therefore, in our case, in America's case, the people must change before the land can change. I saw a short thing from Hillsdale College where one guy was talking about, he said, I hate telling people, but we have exactly the government that we voted for. Now, we could argue some of that because a lot of people make promises that then they get and don't deliver. I understand. But the point is well taken. So let's just cut to the nub of all this. This verse is an observation. Can you agree with that? It doesn't come right out and tell us do this or do that, does it? It's not a verse that has a command in it. It's just an observation. All it does is describe for us the conditions that are necessary for the longevity of liberty. However, through its description, it reveals to us what has to happen. It tells us exactly what must happen if America is ever again to be the land of the free. And that is, her people must become men and women of understanding and knowledge. Amen. Someone says, oh, man, preacher, I'm so glad to hear you say that because I am just such a big proponent of education. I mean, I've just been saying, we just got to get our education back on track. Whoa, hold it. That's not what I said. No. You misunderstand where I'm headed here. See, dear friends, the problem is not that we lack understanding of science and math, though we do. The problem is not that over 20% of our high school graduates are functional illiterates, though they are. The problem is not that we have only a rudimentary knowledge of literature and history. Those are problems, but they are not the problem. The problem is that the people of this country do not understand or know the living God. That's the problem. And our nation is now in a rapid descent into tyranny because her people do not know God. That's the issue. That's the problem. As a people, we no longer know God. What could be done about that? Let's stop and think about that. Everybody's so concerned right now that Joe Biden is a vegetable. Can't put two sentences together and, oh, our country's in bad shape now. If Joe Biden was mentally fit as a fiddle, it would not change the state of our country. We're so focused on 7 months from now, however many months it is now, 5 months, the election. We're going to retake the House, or retake the Senate. We're going to get Trump in office. Look, I want all those things. I'll just be open. I want all those things. But that's not the problem with our country. That's not going to fix anything. You talk about rearranging chairs on the Titanic. I mean, that's ludicrous. What can actually be done about it? How do we address the problem, not the symptoms? What can be done about it? Solomon actually tells us. Go back to Proverbs 2. Look what Solomon says. Look in verse 1. My son, if thou wilt receive my words. By the way, young people, it's not about hearing the words. What does it say? There's a difference between being told something and actually listening to what you're told. You have to be teachable. My son, if thou wilt receive my words and hide my commandments with thee. Young people, what does this sound like? Haven't we heard this recently? What does this sound like? Where did we hear this? Where, Katie? At camp. It's almost like this is the exact thing they were harping on all week. My son, if thou receive my words and hide my commandments with thee. What's he talking about? And he says this, so that thou incline thine ear unto wisdom and apply thy heart to understanding. Look at the words. Yea, if thou criest after what? Knowledge, and liftest up thy voice for understanding. If thou seekest her as silver and searchest for her as for hid treasures, then shalt thou understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. For the Lord giveth wisdom. Out of his mouth cometh knowledge and understanding. It could not be any simpler. You want knowledge, you want understanding. Oh my goodness, ladies and gentlemen, if this country is ever going to be restored to a land of freedom and liberty, we are going to have to get back into this book right here, where the words of the living God have been revealed and preserved for us. This is where we get knowledge and understanding. It's going to take an absolute revival. In the matter, I'm so tired. I watched some of these charlatan preachers on television talk about, oh, there's revival sweeping America. You're an idiot. I mean, you're just, That's ludicrous. And yet they think, oh, well, we're hearing prophetic words and we've got all this stuff. Listen. We have all the prophetic words we need right there. And we're not doing it. And no one's searching for it as for hidden treasures. No one's inclining their ear. Friends, it is going to take a revival in the matter of searching the scriptures as if you lost a chunk of gold in there. Going through it and sifting for it, looking for it. It's as if hidden treasures, that's what it says. And they are hidden treasures. God doesn't just pour out his knowledge freely. You have to go looking for it. That's why Paul says to Timothy, study to show thyself approved unto God. And to be perfectly honest and candid with you, when I see the attitude of the average Christian toward the Word of God, does that give you hope? When I see the attitude of the average Christian towards the Word of God, I honestly feel virtually hopeless for America. But can I just remind you, it doesn't have to be that way for us. I don't get the chance to preach to every Christian in America. And they're probably very thankful for that, okay? But I'm saying to you and to me, I have your attention tonight. And it doesn't have to be this way for us. I think about the revival that happened, or whether some people call it the revival under Josiah. They had all these but in reality, it was only on the surface. The people, their heart didn't change. But there were a few, and God came to them and said, listen, the nation doesn't want to hear, but you can be right. You can be in a right relationship with me. You can know me. And I'm saying for all of us, it doesn't have to be. We don't have to go the way that the rest of the country goes. And for America's sake, it can't be that way with us. You know, I want to preserve Parker County as long as I can. Amen. I want to have a good place for us to live as best as I can. I want Texas to be a bastion of sanity and hope. I don't want us to lose sight of just basic human truth. Right? And so of all people, the folks at Southside Baptist Church ought to be people of this book. Amen. We ought to be people of this book so that we can understand and know God. Get back to the book. We ought to. It's not enough for one man or one church to know the God. The whole land of America needs to come back to this. I praise God that I've read the Bible and I understand what is coming. The tribulation time is coming. And when it comes, there's going to be a revival. By that time, it'll be a little bit late. And they'll have to endure horrific persecution before Jesus comes. But there is a revival coming, and we can light the match. We got to get back to the Bible. That means that the hearts, and I'm just going to say, a lot of times the reason we don't read the Bible is not because we're too busy, it's because we don't want to. I mean, honestly, we just don't want to. It's not fun, and we've conditioned ourselves to be like the microwave community where we just want to have instant gratification on everything. And sometimes you just got to get down and grit your teeth and get back to it. And that's a great response to the invitation. Maybe you should just come tonight and say, Lord, rekindle the love. Give me back my desire for your word. Our hearts must be changed. Our habits have to change. I appreciated Danica so much the other night when she was giving her testimony, talked about reading the Bible. It's so easy to get in the habit, isn't it, of just checking off the boxes. We even have a checklist on our Bible reading schedule so that you can check the boxes. And I don't know what chemical that sets off in your brain, but like that little check, it does feel good, doesn't it? We have to get past that and get back to the habit of actually reading, spending some time with the Lord, understanding what God is trying to say, and let it talk to you, let it minister to you, where you realize what God wants from you. The hearts and habits of the people must change. But listen, here's a question for the land. On what basis is Parker County? In what basis is Texas? On what basis is America? What basis are they going to change? Who is going to teach the nation about God? Who is going to teach the nation about God's word? Is the government going to do it? Speaker Johnson, is he going to do it? Are we going to leave it to the teachers' unions? Certainly we can't leave it to the president. Dear friends, and we're not supposed to leave it to any of those people. I submit to you tonight that the only instrument, the only vehicle capable of bringing an understanding and a knowledge of God to the people of this country are the churches of the living God. And that's why this country is in desperate need of churches like ours who are again preaching the word, who are not worried about all the social change and all the LGBTQ plus whatever else it is now agenda. I don't care 2 cents about that. What we need is this. Amen. And we need to get back to churches who are preaching the Word of God. Amen. That is the only way to spread an understanding and knowledge of God. Amen. Is to build churches. And so I'm just saying, how important is it that our teens, for example, go to camp and get their heart right and are challenged, as Katie just said, about living in this book and making it a part of your life and spending some time in it? How important is it that young families surrender to God and commit to restructure their family around the teachings and principles and truths of this book? How important is it that you and I invest in and help train the next generation of leaders in a biblical worldview so that they can lead us down that path? Dear friends, here's how important it is. Freedom itself depends on it. Amen. Depends on it. You love America? What are you doing to keep her free? Do you know God? Listen to what Jeremiah said. This is in the days. He lived through that time with Josiah when the nation was on the precipice. Here's what God said to him. Thus saith the Lord, let not the wise man glory in his wisdom, neither let the mighty man glory in his might. Let not the rich man glory in his riches, but let him that glorieth glory in this, that he understandeth and knoweth. That's what it comes down to. Let's stand together. Lord, we love you tonight, and God, we thank you for your incredible word. It's so wonderful. And Lord, I confess that I am not nearly as in love with your word as I ought to be. I don't spend near as much time with it as I should. Help me set the right example in our church, in my home, for my friends. Lord, help me once again to rekindle the love in my heart for your word, the desire to actually know you, not knowing all kinds of facts and things about you, but to know you, your character, your personality, to be changed by you as I meet you in your word. Lord, I pray for your people. May our church be a light where when folks come, they realize that we're not about the latest political agenda. We don't care about all the stuff going on. What we care about is this book. Lord, help us to be a people that spends time knowing, cherishing, seeking it as for hidden treasures. Cherishing it. Trying to apply its principles to our life, to obey it, to receive the instruction, not just to hear it, but to put it to use. God, help us to be a people of the book who understand and know you. God, we pray for our country. It's in such a mess. We can just see how you've been cast aside and thrown out. And all these people who said, well, we didn't need religion, are now coming back to realize that actually we can't survive without Christianity. Our country's been given over to a reprobate mind, and we are sinking so fast. You promised judgment. The wicked shall be turned into hell and all the nations that forget God. And we are living proof of it. God, you're a God of grace and mercy. We pray that with us, you would start again, kindle a revival. Revival of love for your word. And help us to make liberty last a little longer. We pray it in Jesus' name.